So, Shamus, how have you been this week?
I've been fantastic. Thank you, Paul. How are you?
Pretty good. Summer's finally arrived, so it's hot and humid here. But I mean, not like real hot. It's like 85.
It's California hot.
Yeah, it's not on fire, so things are fine.
Two seasons. The two seasons of California. Rainy and fire. Or is it just
Yep.
summer and fire? Or mudslides and fire?
Yeah, it's like earthquake slash mudslide and then fire and drought, I think. Some of the seasons last for several years. So what kind of video game stuff you been doing this week?
Right, well, this week is kind of interesting. I complained a few weeks ago that I played some crazy what was I can't even remember what it was called now. Oh, right, Phantasy Star Online. And it was terrible. Like, I liked the robot suits, but like you just had entirely too much talking. Like, oh, shut up and let me play. And I played another game that has a similar problem, but it has handy buttons to like skip story, skip dialogue, skip story, skip dialogue. It seems to be aware that you don't care. It's I've
Or there's
never
a
heard of this.
potential you
It's
don't care.
right. I've never heard of this thing. It's apparently been around for years. It's called Soulworker. It's very much anime. I mean, this is like made to look like modern anime with shaders and everything. So it just looks like an anime. And it's very much, dress up your waifu kind of game.
Is this
But
like Ruby kind of anime, or like it is more like a harem anime?
I would say Ruby, I think. I just based on the few still frames I've seen of Ruby, yeah, it's that kind of style, I think. Maybe more knowledgeable anime fans can set me right, but that's what I think it's like. And it has kind of cool action combat. I haven't played a lot of it, and I'm not going to be with this game for very long. But this was like, yeah, I blew my Saturday on this ridiculous anime game and had a good time. And that helped me to recover from Phantasy Star Online.
So just
I
like
actually.
hanging out and talking to people and hitting things with swords or something, or
We're not talking to people. I mean, there are people ever. It's really weird. Okay, there were only six. Like, normally there would be six character classes or whatever. In fact, in most games, it's like eight. This one has only six character classes, and they are also characters. Like, when you play the person with the big sword, you're playing it's the one I'm most familiar with. Okay, smallest person, biggest weapon. And it's. I mean, that's. That's my thing. That's the character I want to play all the time, is the smallest person with the most ridiculously oversized weapon. And it y you play and you have that character's name. You are playing as that character, right? Like you're playing as Bob or Janet, although they've got, names I can't remember. So it's like you're Janet and you get into the world, and it shunts you into a part of the world with similar classes. So if you're a Janet, you go to this particular town as your starting town. So does every other Janet. So it is just this overwhelming, you're supposed to be this unique character, but you are an identical clone of every other Janet in the world. And so.
so you not only look like every other person who's playing your class, but everyone is in the same towns like Janetopia, where everyone looks the same.
Exactly.
Are the
Yeah.
NPCs also Janets? I mean, that would be icing on the cake, right?
No, they're not. They all actually all look very individual. The reason I think they do this, I think this is deliberate, is the game is very much trying to sell you doll clothes. Dress up in sexy outfits or whatever. I mean, there's boys in here too. There aren't any men in the game, in the sense that you can't play somebody that's, built like Henry Cavill. You know, right. Somebody with a bunch of... You play as an adorable girl or an adorable boy. That's your choice. You can't play so it's some like middle-aged... Bishi
and chibi.
Yeah, those are the words I was looking for. Yeah, that's what you can... And that's a valid... You know, it's not like, oh, how dare you not have a giant, you know, bruiser. That's what this game wants to do. And... It's fine, but what they really want to do is get you so that you can feel like an individual. You're supposed to buy doll clothes for your little Barbie or Ken doll. And I, of course, sure. Didn't care about that. I just, you know, run around in town, click on everybody with a question mark over their head. The game even has a skip this entire dialogue button. Like, they know what's up. There's like a back and forth dialogue you're supposed to have, and then there's a shortcut button to skip all of it and just, yeah, okay, I don't care, I'm just gonna follow the arrow. And it is kind of fun. Like, every once in a while I'll see a line of dialogue and I'll just have no idea what's going on or who my friends are or what anybody's agenda is. It's just, you know, oh, I'm supposed to walk into this doorway, into this instance, and you know what? I'm just going to walk through this instance killing things, and I'm pretty sure I'll get the quest done that way.
And so, at the end of the quest, they're like, why did you kill all those innocent civilians? What's wrong with you? And you're like, skip dialogue.
It would be brilliant if they subverted it like that, and you'd find out you're actually being this horrible person. Oh, don't kill anything in here. It's all adorable kittens, and if you get to the end and pull the lever, they'll turn back into adorable kittens, and you'll break the spell on them. And meanwhile, getting a 500-hit combo on them. And, you know, it's very much group fighting, so what you want to do is kind of rodeo around them, get them all in one big bunch, and then start hitting so that you build up these incredible combos. I don't know if that's what you're supposed to be doing, but nice. That's what I've been doing, and I really like it. So it's a cute game. I had fun with it, and I appreciate that they left an allowance in for people who don't care about the story. Even better. You know, the other thing that makes this way better than Phantasy Star Online is the dialogue audio is in Japanese. And boy, that helps so much. Like, when you hear really cringy, cliche, stupid dialogue and it's in a language you know, you can feel it. You're like, oh, it's so terrible. I feel bad for inhabiting this world. But as far as I know, everyone I've talked to has been a philosopher king.
Eloquence and concise phrases everywhere.
Right. They're just all brilliant. They have incredible stories. And I've just been skipping them all. And I can continue that fantasy as long as I continue hitting the skip button.
That's a really good point. If you've got poetry in some other language and it's translated, you can be like, oh, well, it was poetry in that language. But if it's spoken in your language, it's really hard to for your language processing center to be like, no, it's fine. This is another language. It's like, no, this is in English, and I know, and this is not Shakespeare, and I can tell.
Right? This isn't Shakespeare. This isn't translated. It's just terrible, stupid English. So, Soulworker. I don't know what the heck's up with that. I've never heard of it before, but it's free to play. It wasn't too, you know, it isn't pushing too hard on selling things. It's just when you fire up the game, it's like, hey, here's some, you want a new outfit? You're probably sick of the newbie outfit. And I'm like, click. No, thank you. Time to stab a million billion spiders. So, I don't know. Good I'm times. Very curious if anybody on my site has heard of this game, much less played it. I'd just love to hear about it, because for me, this was a complete surprise. I've never heard of it before. I downloaded it pretty much randomly, and I had a good Saturday with it, although I don't know if I'll go back. So, have you played any good games? You know, according to the show notes, you haven't. This looks like work. What have you been doing, Paul?
I have been working. I really didn't have time for video games this week. I saw that, what is it? Exapunks is on sale on GOG, and I was like, oh, I should get some Exopunks. And then I was like, nope, I am so busy. But I know that last week we talked about Good Robot being open source, and I was like, I should download the source for Good Robot and see what's up. And so I did. I downloaded the source for Good Robot, and I was like, I don't have a way to compile this. It's not in Python. So I broke down and installed Visual Studio, the community edition. And boy, was that an experience.
That's the edition that the game was run in, was developed in, if you're curious.
Oh, really?
Hippie Freeloader. Okay. Yeah, Hippie Freeloader edition all the way.
Awesome. It was not bad. I mean, the installer is actually a downloader.
Right.
So that wasn't great. That, you know, when we talked about installers last couple weeks ago about, like, you know, installers that download downloaders. But this one had a new twist, because the installer is a downloader that downloads an installer, and that installer that it downloads is also a downloader. So it was like a two-tier. They put a hat on it, and then the hat also had a hat. It was pretty impressive.
It's fractal.
Yeah, and probably. Well, because when I started it up, it was like, hey, activate your Azure credits for your Active Directories and your developer services. Microsoft will help you connect with your peers and develop synchronies. And I was like, what? Is this whole program just a downloader for more downloaders?
Right. Microsoft always has some very funny ideas about what I want to do with their software. Like, they're like, okay, you downloaded the Hippie Freeloader edition of Visual Studio. Now you probably want to connect with the rest of the people that work in your mega corporation so that all of you can coordinate and synergize together as a productive team and connect with leadership teams and send each other messages through micro. And I'm like, shit, man, I don't even have any friends. What are you talking about? I don't know people. I don't program with people. What are you talking about?
I program exclusively to get away from people.
Right.
So I was also a little bit surprised, I guess, at the tack they were taking. They're like, man, you must be sitting in a fancy office somewhere. I'm like, well, I guess it depends on what you mean by that. But no, you can keep your Azure credits. Thank you.
Right.
So I guess they've got like some sort of fake money store or something built into it. I don't even know.
It gamifies programming. Just yeah. 10 more XP until you get to the next level, and then you can update a new animated cursor for when you're compiling.
Oh, man. So before I even opened up Good Robot, I booted it up, and I was kind of poking around in the menus and stuff, and there's like a Service Explorer, and they've got a whole toolbox with widgets you can drag and drop in there. I was like, man, this is very complicated. Where do I get the text? Like, isn't this supposed to be displaying text somehow?
Right.
But I did manage to open it up. Good Robot's got a whole project, a Microsoft Visual Studio project in there. I just clicked on it and it opened it right up. Except before it opened it up, it was like, warning, the project file Good Robot could present a security risk by executing custom build steps when opened in Microsoft Visual Studio that could cause you damage to your computer or compromise your private information. Are you sure you want to do this? And I was thinking, hang on, Microsoft, you're the one who's allowing this project file to possibly compromise my computer and execute custom build steps. I didn't ask you to do that. You're telling me that you have no choice but to execute custom build steps. Can't I just check the box saying, execute no custom build steps? Is that a thing I could do?
Right. It's almost like it's kind of the problem with Microsoft Docs had back in the 90s. They added this whole system for making macros, collections of commands.
Yeah, yeah.
And it's like, oh, so you can, you know, hit this and it'll do 10 complicated things that you always do. And they made it more and more powerful and more and more powerful, and nobody was asking them to do that. And when it was done, it was like, holy cow, macros can download crap and give me malware. And it's like, why did you make
the macros are Turing complete? Why did you do that?
Right. And it's like, why did you make your custom build system? Why didn't you make a wall between, you know, a normal build system and some ultra complicated super needs to copy files into the system folders compile system that, you know, 0.001% of people will ever use. For most people, the custom build is just, okay, I want a debug build. That's it. Just right. Start the compiler with the debug options. My custom build step does, when it's done compiling, copy goodrobot.exe out of wherever it's a tar, you know, wherever it's compiled to, you know, and copies it a few levels up in a directory set aside for the game itself, where all the, you know, art files are, and then run it from there. That's take the file you just now compiled and run it. And it's like, well, I mean, I suppose that's a risk. If you just compile unknown code and hit run, that'd be a hell of a way to give people malware. Is just the source okay, code for the malware.
And then download Microsoft Visual Studio and install it. And then uncheck the show me this every time on this project file could contain security risks. And then compile it, and then run the executable. And then click OK when Microsoft security thing pops up. And then email us your credit card information.
Right, it's like, just send them the source code for your malware and make them compile it themselves. They'll never see it coming.
So does it actually... Is it actually possible to make some sort of like custom thing that will run on Project Open? Or is this just something where it's like, hey, warning, if you build this thing, it might cause problems?
On Project Open, I am not aware of anything you can do on Project Open that is harmful. Yeah, but you can do arbitrary system. I mean, I know there's sort of a box where you can just type in. Maybe this is going back too far, but like when I worked at Active Worlds, there was a box where you just type in the DOS commands you would use. Like, oh, copy this file from here to here and rename it. You know, so the thing that's called debug.exe will be renamed to, you know, aw.exe or something like that. You know, just nothing scandalous, but it was just run some DOS commands. Which obviously could be a problem.
Right. Yeah. I was just surprised it was like executing when opened. And I was like, when opened? Really? This? Because I know, like you said, in Microsoft Office, you can make macros that run on file open that will do stuff. And it's really annoying because some of the settings, like in Excel, I don't know if this is all versions of Excel or just the one I was using, but you can't turn on iterative calculation in Excel. You like per file, you have to turn it on like for the whole program. And when you turn it on for the whole program, it won't stay turned on. You have to turn it on every time you open Excel. And so to get around that, you can make a macro that when you open the file, it automatically changes your setting in Excel to turn it on. But then you have to make it a macro enabled file. And so then when you save it, it doesn't automatically save as a macro enabled file. It always saves it as a normal file. And then it asks you like, hey, got custom macros. Are you sure you want to save it as no? And I'm like, no, I just want you to save it as a macro file. And I want you to run the macros every time. And then if you update Excel, it turns off automatically run macros. And so then when you try to run your file, it's like, hey, this got macros in it. And we turned them off for you. Don't worry. We're protecting you. And I was like, no, Microsoft.
We made this super dangerous system, and then we made this system so much more complicated and powerful than it needed to be, even though you never asked for that. And then because it's so complicated and dangerous, we have turned it off by default to keep you safe from the feature that we made that you didn't want. And, you know, it's like, really all I wanted was something to, like, automatically recalculate this thing when I load it or whatever. Ugh.
It's like they took a calculator and then they covered it in spikes and then they duct taped a bunch of pillows over it. And I was like, I can't use a calculator anymore, guys. The whole point is it's a calculator.
That's a good analogy. We covered it in electrified spikes, but don't worry. We've put pillows all over it.
And oh, dear.
So, I see at the end of your notes, you ran into something that I totally forgot about.
Yeah, I tried to compile your game. I was like, oh, this is fun. Let's see if it will compile before I make any major changes. And it needs boost. And boost is huge.
Boost is ridiculous. And I think if you have something you put over your ears before you hear or are exposed to heretical statements, please put those on now. Boost is sort of proof that C++ is a hot mess, is an absolute disaster of a language that has been sort of run aground, missing so many key features that you need, that seem like, why are these things missing? They seem foundational. And other ones are like, well, how can you get anything done without these? Do we really need to have these as external libraries? Or even if they should be external libraries, why are they so honking big? Yeah, Boost is 600 megabytes, and that's the source code. Source code is 600 megabytes. I mean, okay, there's some non-source code in there, but it is, I am not kidding you, when you download the latest version of Boost, you got to open up the project file. You don't get the libraries. You get the raw source. You open it in, or you run the batch file on it, and you walk in a DOS window. That's right. You go into a DOS window, and you kick off the compile process, and it takes, on a modern computer, 20 minutes. I am not joking. That is,
that, so I mean, can't how even, do you, I've never, it's asking for filesystem.hpp, but it can't find it for some reason. It's already in here. Like, I downloaded the whole thing. There's all these HPP files.
Weird. I'm not sure about that. But yeah, Boost is so ginormous. And almost everybody needs one or two things in Boost. And when that happens, everybody has to download and compile this absolute behemoth. And it's just a terrible system. It's a terrible system for, like, the 1001 things this language needs.
Crazy.
That should be part of some sort of standard library. And why is this such a nightmare? Oh, it's bad. It's bad and it's miserable and I hate it. And every time I load up C#, I'm like, I don't have to worry about that. It just works. Okay, it's, it's much slower and wastes so much more memory, but it's so easy. As long as I never do anything important that needs to be performant, I never have to go into that nightmare again.
Man. Well, I'm not to the point where I can compile it yet, but I tried. And I also discovered that there are a lot of the settings, some of the things I was trying to change were actually in the XML files, and I didn't know. So there's a ton of stuff in those XML files.
Really? Like what?
Well, like the level complete thing, like the text when you finished a level. I was going to try to change it so that it would keep displaying the name of the level when you finish it, when you clear it. And so I was like, oh, okay, well, where is the actual text? And so I searched for the actual text that displays on the screen because I figured that would be in the source code. But no, it's in an XML file. The code that displays it is in the source code, of course, but the code, like the text itself, is out on the hard drive.
Well, that's cool. It's cool. I'm sorry you ran into Boost. That sucks. It would be much easier. I mean, and Boost, we included, like, we have SDL, a library that does all this crazy rendering and talks to OpenGL and creates windows. And it's, you know, teeny, infinitesimally smaller than Boost, even though it's doing something large and sophisticated. And most of the stuff we needed for Boost was, oh, I forget what it was. But it was 10 very small things we needed Boost for.
Ugh.
Arvin's interface code, I think, relied on Boost. So, like, I wasn't using Boost until Arvin joined the project. And he was taking over the interface work. And I was like, fine, whatever I've got to do to not write interface code. Like, when I say interface code, I mean UI stuff. Make menus and windows and display sliders and all that stuff. I hate it. It sucks.
Somebody's got to do it.
Right? And I was really happy to... And Arvin did a great job. It's all good. And he was happy to do it. So, yay. So, I should make it clear to people. I said last month, I'm going to get Horizon Zero Dawn. It came out at the beginning of August.
Ooh.
And here we are at the beginning, or at the middle of August, and I still haven't played it. But it was, apparently, the PC port of that game is a disaster. Like, I was about to buy, like, I was, you know, okay, I'm getting it today, and it had been out for a couple days. And just as I was going through the news that morning, I started seeing all the complaining about, oh, this is such a terrible port. We haven't seen something this bad since Arkham Knight. Oh, it's a disaster. I've got, you know, people with specs like mine, like really high-end computers, can't get the game to hit a stable frame rate. Missing textures, rampant crashes. So I was like, you know, sometimes I get games like that just so I can write an angry article about them. But I just wasn't in the mood. My heart wasn't in it. I'm like, I want to play a game, not write an angry article. So, yeah. So I put it on. Now it looks like, well, they've posted messages indicating that they intend to patch it. So we'll see if that goes anywhere. But this is a bad time to, you know, it's about to get crazy go nuts for game releases. So I don't know.
Yeah.
I'm not going to buy this 3-year-old game if the new hotness is already out for this year. And speaking of which, the first new hotness is coming out tomorrow, for those of you listening to this diecast. This diecast will go up on Monday, and on Tuesday, Microsoft Flight Simulator 2020 comes out.
Ooh.
This is the game that it's like the full data. If you wanted to download the entire game, it would be, you know, you couldn't buy a hard drive to hold the whole thing. It's like hundreds of terabytes. Like, you wouldn't find
Yikes.
That. But it streams it to you a bit at a time, and it's basically the whole Earth. They've just used satellite data. No, it's not. So it's like Google Earth. Imagine if there was a version of Google Earth. Now, of course, satellite images are not sharp enough for close inspection, right? So what they apparently did, and this is so crazy that I have to see this. They apparently took, like, satellite data, which, you know, is kind of blurry and rough, but you can count houses from satellite data, right?
Yeah, yeah.
And they used that as the input for a machine learning algorithm to generate cities. So,
yikes.
So they apparently generated, like, this alternate Earth. And, you know, maybe your house is there, but it will look like just some random American house, you know, from the templates that this learning algorithm has to work with. It will put a house where your house is, right? But it will probably look nothing like your house. And I've got to see that. I will pay $60 just to see that. I must see it. And, you know, see your town as this weird alt-Earth version that doesn't have any of the right stuff, but probably has the correct street layout and the correct topography. I wish they made this a driving game, too. Like, I wish this was just sort of the, not just a flight simulator, but a vehicle simulator. So I could drive around, or fly around, or skateboard around. I mean, just go for it. Just make the ultimate getting around simulator.
Well, there are slewing commands, right? And you can taxi. All you need is to edit in a custom aircraft that looks like a dude on a skateboard.
Right. I was thinking, everybody jokes like, oh, this stupid, you know, single propeller airplane, nobody's going to use that. And I'm like, that's the first thing I'm going to get. And I'm going to fly over, like, places that I know and just land in the street so I can look around.
Right.
Like, I am, even though this is one of those, is this a game or is it not? Because it's a simulator with no win state. But I don't care what you call it. I'm there, day one, $60 up front. I have to see this.
Yeah, it sounds interesting.
So, well, hopefully it works. Because, you know, this is new. Normally I'd be very pessimistic about it because Microsoft is always such a disaster. But I'm not getting it through their game store. I'm getting this on Steam. So that's half of the problem solved, is that I'm getting it on a getting it on a platform that works. And then, you know, a lot of this is based on their cloud computing stuff, which everybody says is awesome. Their Azure cloud computing systems, and that's what they use to make all this data, and that's what's running this giant network that will stream you, you know, your area that you're in. And yeah, and that stuff, I'll bet that part of it, regardless of how the rest of the game works, I'll bet that stuff's going to be solid.
Very cool. It would be neat to get access to that procedural generation stuff and just generate new planets,
right?
New cities, yeah. Right?
Yeah, just feed it like a different, like just feed it the topography and have it figure out, just make this alt world, this modern alt world, modern day. That would be amazing.
Well, they've got the technology. That's neat. Yeah, I'd be interested to see how that turns out. I'm not planning on getting either. Although I did hear Horizon Zero Dawn was a really good game, so I'm kind of sad to hear that the port is not great.
Right. Well, you know, there will be another slough. There will be another slump next summer, and probably the game will be half price by then. So, this doesn't hurt me. You're only hurting yourselves.
Yeah, true.
Do good ports. All right, let's do some mailbags.
Okay.
Oh, this first one ties into what we're talking about.
Dear Diecast, I recently read an article about software disenchantment. There's a link. The feeling of disillusionment when you realize that despite systems vastly growing more powerful, software doesn't run vastly faster. I'm not very up to date with my gaming, but I haven't really noticed the same problems in games, aside from all the install sizes ballooning out of proportion. They seem to run fine with ever more impressive tech. Have you guys noticed games getting slower and bloated as systems improved? Vale, Tim. Thank you for the question, Tim.
So this has been true for a long time. That, oh man, it's always, you know, my computer gets twice as fast and software is half as fast. It requires twice as much power to do the same thing. But I think we're doing all right lately. There's nothing on my machine that when I go to start it up, it just feels like it takes forever and it gets on my nerves. You know what? No, there is one. Steam. Steam always takes like the same 15. It took 15 seconds to start up in 2004. It takes 15 seconds to start up here in 2020. What are you doing, Valve? And Valve is usually pretty good at making software. So yeah, there's one right there. I planned on saying no, I don't have anything. I think we're doing great these days. But yeah. Steam is a slowpoke, and the same is true for rival platforms like Epic Games Store, which is, you know, half the features of Steam, but an even longer startup time, and Origin Dawdles too.
They're all trying to be a downloader platform, downloading stuff all the time.
I wonder if a big part of the slowness of these things is that they all depend on if not on Chrome, not on Chromium, they're web-based, right? Even when you're interacting with the Steam interface, behind the scenes, it's really like a web page, so that all the formatting is handled by CSS and HTML rather than have somebody do a layout like you would do in a Windows dialog box, right? Where somebody positions buttons here and that's the template to work from. And, you know, that works, and it makes the interface flexible, so it can be whatever size your screen is and can rearrange itself as you resize the window. But maybe that's the bottleneck for getting these things to start up, because there's so many layers.
I guess. They're all web pages.
Right. And for whatever reason, just maybe it takes a while to start that engine and feed assets into it, and for it to, you know, it's so many layers deep rather than just start it up and it draws what it needs to draw. And I think a lot of the interface gets downloaded when you start it up. Like, to fill in the store page, Steam has to, like, download a web page. It has to load a really media-rich web page. And so it never feels snappy.
Sure would be nice if you could just tell it, I don't want to download your store right now. I just want to play the games that are already on my hard drive.
Right. Right. It would be nice if it kind of, if it was a little more aggressive about caching, so that when you start it up, it felt snappy. It has never, ever felt snappy. Like when I start my MP3 player, and I've got huge, huge media files in my MP3 player, like, you know, 4-hour electronic mix, right? That's a big honking file. But I can jump from that file, jump to the middle of it, jump to another 8-hour mix. I'm serious, I have an 8-hour mix of music. I don't know who put that together. But jump to the middle of that, and it's all just click, 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 instantaneous response. And then you just load up a web page that just lists the games you own, that supposedly all the assets for these, you know, file icons should already be on your computer. And it just acts like, well, it acts like it's compiling Boost. It's so difficult. So what's the story with you and being disillusioned, Paul? Are you disenchanted with software?
Yeah, it is kind of annoying that computers are so fast and that most software runs so slow. And it would be understandable and I would be acclimated to it, except that there are a few programs that are just nigh instantaneous. And it's not like it's some, you know, really simple thing like Notepad, although Notepad does usually open up pretty quick. But like, what is it? AutoHotkey. AutoHotkey will just instantly start up, and it's not doing, like, it's a whole compiled, it's not compiled, it's an interpreted programming language that, like, has roots all deep in your system, and it's intercepting key strokes and doing interface stuff, and, like, it doesn't have a bunch of fancy UI, but, like, it's doing complicated things.
Right. But it's still crisp.
Yeah, really fast. I wonder if it's the UI, if, like, the people who are designing and coding UI, like the UI code people, just have no concept of performance.
I've got a good example of a fast program is Notepad++. It's like, you know, a better version of Notepad. It does code formatting and everything, but it's still very lightweight. It can just, you know, just the text editing window from Visual Studio and just that and nothing else. Just, it's great for, like, oh, I want to open up a text file or a README or an INI and fiddle with it, right? Notepad++. And it starts up instant, boom, instant every time. It never needs to think about it or load a bunch of widgets. It's not using some incredibly complex package. It's just buttons across the top, text in the middle, go to work.
And then there are UI rich programs that still load kind of fast. I mean, like Blender has got tons of UI and tons of graphic. I mean, it's a whole graphics system. It's got 3D, it's for 3D modeling, right? And that loads up in like 3 or 4 seconds.
I'm going to launch it right now. Click. 2, 3, 4. Oh, you know, I didn't even need to count 4. It's up, but the splash screen didn't go away. And I thought, but it's waiting for me to, like, dismiss. It was ready at 3.
Yeah, 3 seconds.
That, I mean, is it could be better, really good.
It could be worse, yeah, exactly.
It could be a lot worse. That is really good. Okay, hats off to Blender. That is nice and quick. Oh, and all I needed to do was click the mouse. It was ready at 3, and all I needed to do was click the mouse to make the splash screen go away. You can probably even disable that.
You can.
You know what? And doesn't get enough attention from people. Programs that piss off quickly. That's valuable too. You hate when you tell a program yes. to close and it's like, okay, I'm going to close now. And you're like, what are you doing? All you need to do is stop existing. Like, everything you're doing right now is pointless. What are you doing? Freeing your memory? Because the operating system will do that anyway. Just stop.
It's writing its memoirs.
Just stop executing code right now.
Notifying the next of kin. Yeah, yeah, programs that think that they're your operating system and they have to shut down elegantly, and it's like, nah, I'm not counting on you for anything. I closed you because I don't need you anymore.
Right. As long as, you know, if there's something that needs to be saved, okay, that's fair. You know, you'd ask me and I'd say yes, and then you'd save it. But, yeah, if you're not saving any data that belongs to me, then you don't matter. Just stop executing code and go away.
Yeah. I love Jonathan Blow's example of Photoshop. Because, yeah, all those Adobe products are just such sluggards when it comes to starting up. Like, it takes 2 or 3 seconds for it to bring the splash screen up, and then the splash screen sits there for, I don't know, 10 seconds?
Right. And then even when it's open, it's not, then there's a few more extra seconds before it's responsive. And then when you actually select something like new document, then it's sluggish bringing up that window, and then when you activate that window, it's sluggish in doing whatever you told it to do. The ultimate thing, people have been asking me now and again, they're like, hey, Shamus, you're such a Unity fanboy now, and a year ago I would have argued with that, but I'm having trouble coming up with ammunition to argue with that, since it's the only thing I use to make...
Quick, get Godot and boot it up just to say you have.
Right? Well, if I pick up another one, it's going to be Jai. So I don't want to mess with Godot while Jai is waiting, right? Because I don't want to have...
Yeah.
Yeah. So I'm saving that secondary platform space for Jai. But right now, it's Unity. But some people are like, why don't you ever use Unreal Engine? You know, that's the industry standard. And then the other day on YouTube, I saw somebody, this was a professional game developer, talking about how when he went indie, you know, why don't regret, switching to Unity? And he talks about programming, he talks about when you've got a big project in Unreal Tournament Engine, or I'm sorry, not Unreal Tournament, Unreal Engine.
Well, I mean, it used to be the same thing, right?
Right, it did. So when you've got something... We were making fun of Boost for taking 20 minutes. It can take over an hour to compile your project if you're working on something in the AAA space in Unreal Tournament. Oh, man. In Unreal. An hour. An hour. How many thousands of hours of productivity will that destroy over the course of a project? Oh, I made that change, but I missed something. I've got to make it again. Now everybody's waiting another hour. Oh, well, I'll try and work on something that's not our immediate project, but it's, you know, somewhere on the schedule just to redeem this 1 hour while we're waiting for this compile. And so Unity is not great. Unity is sluggish like an Adobe project, but the compile times are not bad. They are comparable to Visual Studio. 2, 3, maybe 5 seconds if you've got a large project. You know, and this is in stark contrast to what Jai promises but has not yet delivered, which is, you know, half second. Which it's
right.
Like,
well, and the reason that Unity can do that is because it's not doing a full compile, right? It's just compiling the stuff that you're working on, and everything else is already in like ready to go JIT code or whatever.
Right. So it keeps everything hot, and it just when you tab back to the program, it immediately looks for changed source files and compiles only the changed files. So it's just this weird little hiccup when you alt tab back. Like, you know, once, if you've got a really small project, you won't even feel it. It'll just be instant. But, you know, once you've got, you know, a few dozen files, then you can feel that little hitch when you come back to it. But that's better than an hour. Like, I don't know what it would be like if I had a full AAA project in Unity, but I'm guessing at worst you're looking at a minute. That's like the most extreme, it would be like a minute, which is 60 times faster than Unreal.
Right. And
you think about that. That is so damaging to productivity. You know, it's like 2 minutes is more damaging, is not twice as damaging as a 1 minute compile. It's like 10 times as damaging because you're in that state of concentration and you can't keep concentrating while your whole system just seizes up. Your mind begins to wander. It's sort of like in the middle of your jog where you're, you know, suddenly frozen in place for 2 minutes. That really throws off your rhythm. Right?
Yeah. You get to the crosswalk and you're like, what do I do now?
Right. And you're not allowed to be, you know, you're playing red light, green light, red light, and you're not allowed to move. And it's like, this is stopping my working out. And yeah, you break somebody's concentration and it takes more than that 2 minutes to get it back. So yeah, that's hugely damaging to productivity. But then I'm sort of agreeing with the premise that speeding up compile times is the big go-to thing everybody should be working on.
Yeah. And the crazy thing about Jai, supposedly, is that it's a full compile, it's not an incremental. So it's like full compile from source all the way to executable in like a fraction of a second. Just insanely fast.
Right. And I've got my hopes up that that'll be a reality. But of course, that was supposed to be out, in 2019?
Yeah, it was.
And here we are. We've crossed the halfway mark of 2020, and it's still not out. So that's sad. I just watched some more videos.
It's in closed beta anyway, but yeah.
Yeah, but I mean, I watched some videos on it recently. Oh, no, I just saw somebody interviewing John Blow about it, and he was talking about how great it's going to be, and I'm like, yeah, sounds great. Let's try it. I don't need you to sell me anymore. It's like when the waiter comes out and starts listing all the wonderful food and how good it's. Yeah, I'm ready to order. Just shut up.
They walk out the door and you can smell the wafts of aroma coming from the kitchen. They're like, do you smell that, sir? Would you like some of it?
And I'm like, yeah. And he's like, well, let me read you the menu first.
We're making sure that the kitchen doesn't burn down. It's not burning down right now. Just let me have some food. Oh, well.
Hi, Shamus and Paul. I don't think you've ever played Fire Emblem that I know of. That's true. After the Dark Souls punishment question last week, I thought it would be interesting to hear you consider how they handle punishment. Every time, I'm going to skip some, but the full question will be in the show notes below. Every time a character dies, you have a dynamic choice. Is it someone you cared about? Probably want to reset. Your crutch unit who's carried the last few maps? Same thing. But maybe you're at the end of a really challenging stage and you just want to be done. Someone died, but you can probably move on without them. So yeah, you can just... That's all I'm going to read here. What do you think of this dynamic player-driven punishment approach? How do you think it could apply to other genres? And either this person forgot to sign, or I did not copy paste their name. I will look for it when I put the show notes up. Thank you, unknown person. So, I mean, you know, what do I think of this? This is how it used to be.
And well, this is kind of the opposite of the thing that we're complaining about all the time of mandatory failure in cutscenes, and like you're not allowed to fail until it's mandatory in a cutscene. This is like, hey, you can fail if you want, and like, and that's fine, and the game will keep going. You don't even lose the level. You just can move on.
Right. And this is the way it used to be all the time. I used to have this conundrum when I played the original Fallout, which is which connects to the next question, actually. But yeah, the original Fallout, you hire Ian because you don't know any better. And for those of you who haven't played Fallout 1 yet, when you do, leave Ian's happy ass there in Shady Sands. Leave him to live his life out there. You do not deserve to have him shoot you in the back. Not because he's betraying you, but because he's absolutely incompetent. He promises he's good with the submachine gun, and by good he means every time he fires, he always hits something. The number of times I saw the game over screen because Ian just tried to shoot a bad guy who is directly on the other side of my torso. Anyway, yeah, you're playing Fallout 1. Ian drops dead and you think, the dog dies. And you think, okay, this person I like died. I can just live with that and accept that as part of the story that I'm making. Or I can save scum and keep them around. And it's totally up to you. And nobody's required. Nobody is forced to die in a cutscene. And you're not forced to keep anybody alive or even bring them with you. And how do I feel about that? I love it. It's obviously not viable in a world where all your companions are voice acted, because nobody wants to, what if the players throw out our 3 hours of voice acted dialogue? We can't let them do that.
Maybe they could just do the voice acting like they do the city generation in Microsoft Flight Simulator.
I've wondered about that. I wonder if that day is coming when we will be able to have... I mean, it's probably not far off. We can already have neural networks that will generate passable... like a specific voice, like 5-second clip of Arnold Schwarzenegger talking, and you can have it then read text in his voice.
Right.
And... that wouldn't be great for... I mean, it's not going to be able to emote. I wouldn't want to have, like, some gut-wrenching moment. But for those NPCs that are just staying there, hey, you know, the space rats are in our power plant and you have to go shoot them. You know, go shoot 10 rats or whatever. Those people...
yeah.
Okay, Bethesda will be the first people to use this.
Because well, and it seems like it if most. You can get something, if you can get a computer to convert text into something that sounds like a specific person talking, it can't be that big of a step to go from there to a specific person with a specific emotion. Like, there's not that many emotions. You just have like 10 different clips of them in different emotional states and have the computer figure it out.
Sure, but I think, like, for the really serious characters, you want to hire your Sean Beans and Patrick Stewarts and Liam Neesons.
Yeah, probably so.
But you know, for all those, you know, think about how much, you know, all the voice acting that went into Oblivion, you know, hundreds of hours, but the stuff people care about are Patrick Stewart and Sean Bean, who probably all of their voice lines together are, you know, maybe 15 minutes worth of lines. And, you know, then there's hundreds of hours of people saying, you know, hello there, stranger, and hey, watch it. You know, it's stuff that does not require you to hire a human being and pay them by the hour to read, "Welcome to my shop." Are you interested in anything particular today?
Or, boy, that battle was tough, wasn't it? You know, sitting around the campfire talking to your NPC buddies.
Right.
And it seems that's not actually a difference in the mechanics. But as far as the question goes, it seems like that would make a big difference as far as your investment in these characters. Like, oh, this guy that you've been chatting at the campfire every night, you know, just got killed in this horrific conflict. Do you want to try that again? Or are you okay with not having him there tonight at the campfire?
Right. Right. It's interesting. The day's probably coming when everybody feels like a real character, where you don't have this two-tier thing where some have a voice and some don't.
Maybe we could even have, gasp, the player character feel like a real character.
Yeah, you die 4 minutes into the adventure because one guy can't take on four soldiers at the same time. Because one guy can't fight six mercenaries.
Yeah, I was more thinking that we could maybe have like a real choice of dialogue options where the player character isn't channeled into this, you know, oh, you get three options, but they all mean the same thing kind of deal.
Do you want to agree in a friendly way or do you want to rudely agree? It's like, oh, the choices matter.
Oh, dear. Dear Diecast. First off, I'd like to thank you for the Fallout recommendation a few months ago. This is Fallout 1. I've been thoroughly enjoying the game repeatedly since, though I do still like New Vegas more. Skipping to the end,
fair.
The question will be in the notes. Do you know any other major retcons from video games? What are your favorites and least favorite retcons? So he's talking about how Fallout 2 has some features that don't really appear in Fallout 1, even though they should be obvious in the world.
And, well, the real one they get into... is the one that gets mentioned specifically here is the idea that vaults are all wacky experiments by the evildoers at Vault-Tec. And that's something that is not really part of the feel, that would feel a little out of place in Fallout 1. And it's something that the newer games have basically built the entire game around. I don't know if you want to call it a retcon or a footnote of the original design that has been made a central pillar. I don't know, but yeah.
It's certainly a change in tone, which is another kind of weird thing where like you have a whole world that has a specific tone and then you have another game that has a very different tone but is supposedly set in the same world.
Right.
Which is kind of touches on that problem of science fiction planets, right? Like, you go to a science fiction planet, and, like, no matter where you land on the planet, it has the same climate. Whereas real planets, like the Earth, has a huge range of climates and locales and stuff. But it's like, we're just going to simplify it, and this whole thing is just this one feel. And games do that, too, where, like, anywhere you go in the game world, it all has the same kind of feel because they're simplifying it. They're making it so that if it's a cohesive experience. But I don't know if it's really necessary that you have to have a cohesive tone between games set in a specific setting. I mean, the setting itself could be dark, but there's no reason you can't have a dark comedy in a dark setting or vice versa.
So I've got two examples. One of a retcon that bothered me and another of a retcon which I think was a good idea. The first retcon is the Borderlands series. In the first Borderlands game, you were looking for the vault. There was a vault somewhere out there. Everyone thought it was a myth. This is just like, who ever heard? This is such an outlandish idea. A vault full of alien technology that only opens once every 200 years. What a crazy idea. You're a maniac for looking for it.
Then yeah, the Lost City of El Dorado kind of thing.
Yes, exactly. So then the second game came along. And it continued on that with that idea. There was the vault that you opened in the first game. And now that has led us to find another vault. And when you open that vault, it opens up, you know, at the end of the game, spoiler, it opens up a big map showing, oh, look, there are vaults everywhere out there. Okay, the galaxy is filled, the border worlds are all full of vaults, and you see all these pinpoints on the map. and then in the third game,
that's already a pretty major retcon, right? Like, if these things are everywhere, then why has no one found one yet?
Right, and why did people only know about this one? There wasn't the legend of the vaults. It was just the vault. And now they're apparently all over the place. But even worse, when you get to Borderlands 3, apparently vault hunting has been a thing for decades before your hero showed up. Like, oh, no, people have been finding vaults for years. The vault on Borderlands 1? That was like the sixth vault that they've opened. It wasn't the vault, it was another vault. Like, vault number 6.
So your vault hunters in Borderlands 1 aren't looking for a specific, like, this special artifact. They're just really bad at their hobby.
So that was really unwelcome. I did, like, why did you have to do that? There was nothing in the design of this game that required. Well, they wanted to make up this legendary character that came before you, who was a legendary vault hunter, the original vault hunter. They wanted that character, and then they had to do this massive retcon to make him happen. And I thought it was stupid. I was like, but okay, he's a funny idea for a character and he has his moments, but you had to break the entire premise of the entire series for him to work. Couldn't you, with the infinite power granted to the writer, have come up with some other design that didn't require breaking the entire universe?
Yeah, well, yeah, and even if you wanted to have that character, just make him have found the vault before you, and he sealed it back up, and then he told everyone about it, and they're like, no, you're crazy, and now you have a reason that there are rumors, and you can have your crazy character, and you can still keep, there's only one vault.
It annoys me. It's one of the many reasons I haven't gone back to Borderlands 3. I keep thinking, I could stand to play through Borderlands. I could stand some more Borderlands, but, oh, I'm sick to death of 2. Well, I could play 3. Oh, except 3 feels thematically wrong, tonally wrong. The gameplay is limp, and the story made a hash of the lore in ways that
jokes
no
aren't
future.
Funny.
Right. And then I'm just like, I guess I don't want to play Borderlands. All right, and the retcon, I don't know if we want to call this a retcon. Is it a retcon when we pretend things didn't happen? Yeah, I guess that's a retcon.
Yeah, absolutely.
The new Hitman games do not in any way acknowledge the events of Hitman Absolution, and I am so glad.
Oh, like, nice!
There's no baggage, there's no leftover stuff with, oh, that time you and Diana conspired to fake her death for some reason. And you pretended to leave the agency, but then you were just trying to kill it. You fought that crazy Texan. No, none of that. You cut the barcode off your back. You faked cutting the barcode off the back of your head in a cutscene where you were the only person present. So who are you trying to fool? The audience.
Oh no.
Yeah,
so does it acknowledge games before that, and it just, like, leaves that one out?
I think it sort of resets. It looks at the status quo that the games normally draw from and just returns to that baseline of, you know, you could do that with Star Trek. You could just ignore the last episodes of TNG. TNG didn't, you know. But you imagine if there was a TV show where it's, you know, a private eye.
Sure.
And solving
Monster
crimes.
Monster of the Week, Mystery of the Week, Planet right. of the Week, whatever.
And in the last episode, everybody, like, retires, or they shoot each other, or they decide to open an ice cream shop or something. Just something so incredibly stupid and tonally wrong. And then they get approved for another season, and they sort of ignore that end to the continuity, and they just, like, oh yeah, they're just still here doing their thing, solving solving crimes like they always did. So it sort of like doesn't say it never happened, but it just proceeds as if it never happened, and the events of that aberrant episode are ignored. I appreciate that.
Like every episode of South Park.
Right? Oh yeah, Kenny always comes back to life.
Like, what is that called? Negative continuity, I think.
Right, right. I don't know how many shows have negative continuity.
TV Tropes knows. You're welcome, everyone.
Yeah. 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 Now I have to look that up.
No, don't do it. We have a show to do.
Okay, last one. Hey, Shamus. Oh, this one's for me. This isn't a diecast question. Feel free to include it. However, I did decide to include this for reasons that will become clear in a minute. I recently decided to convert your Mass Effect retrospective series to an EPUB book so that I can, on the move, indulge in my petty bitterness over an 8-year-old game's narrative failures. They go on to say they've only done the first 2 chapters and was wondering whether it would be okay to leave it in the public. Okay, so addressing this. Take care, Naman Dixit. So yes, it's okay that you do that. I've been meaning to do this myself. I know there's a demand for this. People tell me all the time. People have said they want a physical printed copy of this thing. So
nice.
And I am proud of it. It is, of all the retrospectives I've written, my favorite. It's got so many good, like, oh, that's a good thing about writing. That's good writing advice. You know, or that's an interesting episode, like stuff that I forgot I wrote, and then somebody will link to part of it, and I'll go back to see it, and I'll be like, oh yeah, that is good. Oh wait, I wrote this. Oh, that's cool. So yes, I'm fine. It is a good feeling. I'm fine with people just sharing it like this, make it into an EPUB, leave it in the public for people, other people to download, whatever. You can collaborate with people to get it done faster. Whatever works. I humbly request that you would put a link to my blog or a link to the series itself somewhere within the book. I think that would be the sporting thing to do. But, you know, if you don't do that, I'm not going to chase you down with lawyers. And don't sell it for money. Other than that, yeah, it's all good. And good luck with the project. Like I said, this is something that if the public doesn't do it, I will eventually have to do it myself. So that's the show. I will link to all of these emails will be in the show notes. I will link to this person's retrospective EPUB in the show notes for anybody else that's interested in it, if you want to give feedback on that. Thanks to everybody who sent in questions. If you've got a question for the show, the email is diecast@shamusyoung.com. Thanks for listening, everybody. Say see you later, Paul.
See you later. Also, are we going to do that question about Dungeons & Dragons?
No. No, I decided against it.
Okay.
That game's for nerds anyway.